Good morning, everybody, and happy Easter. Happy Resurrection Day might even be the better way to say that. Today, of course, is Easter Sunday, and it's a privilege to be here at Discovery Church and sharing today's message with you about the resurrection of Christ. We have our limit of 10 people here with us today. Four of us will be leading worship in a manner of speaking, and the rest of us, we have an audience. Today, we have the Lord's Supper. I hope you remember to get your communion supplies and that you have them out and ready. We will be doing them at the end of the service today. But we will try to do that in unison as best we can, but don't feel obligated to do that whenever you are ready, as Tom mentioned earlier, whenever the Spirit moves you. But good morning, Facebook Live folks, our Discovery Church family and friends. We're going to start off today with a video. Whenever my wife can get back there to start the video. But this is a casual service, however. We will be observing some very traditional elements of Easter, and I'm just glad that you're here. Let's start with prayer, shall we? Would you bow with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for Resurrection Sunday. Thank you that we serve a risen Savior, and that His name is Jesus, the Savior of the world. Thank you that you have given to us this incredible day that we might celebrate. And I know, God, that there is a sense of excitement in all of our hearts and minds, particularly because we have not been able to collectively meet as a church for many weeks now. I know that there is a sense of longing in all of our hearts and minds. We look forward to the day that we can get back together as an entire church. But God, thank you for platforms like Facebook Live and YouTube, where these videos can be shared and shown and people can see them and still feel connected to Discovery Church and to one another. Thank you, God, that you do an incredible, incredible work in a variety of ways to in a creative way to keep us together. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, especially this day, as we celebrate the risen Christ, your Son, our Savior, and His name is Jesus. And we're going to sing now together, Resurrection Power. Tom, you going to lead us? Oh, it's video.
Resurrection power, literally inside Jesus. Facebook presentation on Wednesday evenings at 6:30. You can tune in and be a part of that very special time of questions and answers and devotion time together. We're going to sing, Christ the Lord is risen today. Christ the Lord is risen today.
Thank you.
friends, for those of you who are joining us on Facebook Live, again, thank you for tuning in. We had a fantastic Sunday last Sunday in terms of tithes and offerings, fantastic week. Thank you so much for your continued faithful giving to the Lord through Discovery Church. Today, we have that same opportunity to exercise our faith, to demonstrate our faith through giving. And I want to remind you, I forgot to ask you, are they on the screen different ways?
No.
Okay. Remind you that there are a variety of ways you can give. First of all, you can still write a check. We still take checks, and you can write those out and send those in the mail, yes, snail mail, to Discovery Church, 4881 Euclid Road, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23462. You can come by the church Monday through Thursday, 9 to 3. We have someone here on staff who will be here to receive your tithes and offerings, and we'll be happy to put them in the treasure chest where they belong. You can text give. You can take out your smartphone, open up your text app, and type in the numbers 73256 and then the word Discovery, and it'll bring up some options for you to give, general fund and so on and so forth. If you're smart like my wife, you might want to just create that as a contact in your list, and you can do that over and over and over. You can also go to our website, www.discoverychurchvb.org, and click on the Donate tab, which is on the top right-hand side of the screen, and you'll find a variety of ways to give there as well. And there was another way. What was it?
Come by the church.
Yeah, come by the church. Oh, no. In addition to coming by the church, Tom said that he will be happy to come pick it up from you. If you would just let us know, he will be happy to come get it. And he'll, of course, make sure it gets put in the bank. But anyway, those are all the ways that you can give to Discovery Church. And hopefully, all of you who are here today have made out your offerings and your envelopes. The treasure chest is right outside these double doors on the left-hand side. Sometime between now and leaving, feel free to navigate out there one at a time, making sure you stay 6 feet apart and drop your offering into the treasure chest. And we have a treasure chest because we want you to know that we treasure your gifts. Simple as that. And we make sure that they're used for God's kingdom's work. And so let's pray right now for those tithes and offerings. Would you bow with me? Lord, thank you that you've given to us many ways that we might exercise and demonstrate our faith and our faithfulness through giving and tithes and offerings. I pray, God, that you will bless each one who is able to give, and that they give lovingly, not out of compulsion, generously from the heart, and they want to see your kingdom's work done here in this church and in their lives. And so bless them in their giving, bless them in their homes. And I know that there's some people without jobs right now, and they may be questioning, how can I give to the church when I have nothing to give? God, impress upon each heart and each mind a way that they can give to you and trust you that you're going to work all things out. And you always do for your glory and for our good. Help us to demonstrate our trustfulness, if I could use that, our trustfulness of you, that you're going to take our tithes and offerings and you're going to multiply them, if need be, to bring about your good, pleasing, and perfect will. Lord, we thank you. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. And we have a video, Resurrection Day. This is my Resurrection Day.
I'm alive.
you, I am changed. And if you're here today and you know Jesus, you've been changed. Amen?
Amen.
And hopefully, someone's going to say today is their resurrection day. They're going to give their life to Jesus. They're going to come to know the peace that passes all understanding. And they too will be changed. Not just changed, but new and improved. The Bible says that the old is gone. Behold, the new has come. All things have become new. Amen?
Amen.
Well, it's a privilege to share with you a message today on He is Risen. Mark, I should say Mark 16, 1 through 11. But nonetheless, maybe I got the wrong number. Did I type the wrong number?
Yeah.
I typed the wrong number. Mark 16. Yeah, Mark 16, 1 through 11. Well, anyway, this is a short series on the resurrection of Christ. So today's a standalone message. We're going to talk about the resurrection itself, but a few more times in this coming month. Easter is a time when we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. You've all come here today to hear a word of encouragement about the resurrection. Hopefully, maybe you hear something new and different. We have the luxury of fully knowing that Jesus did not stay dead. Amen?
Amen.
He rose victoriously from the grave, proving that He and He alone has the power over death. And His resurrection, the fact that He rose from the grave, was witnessed by hundreds or even thousands of people. He appeared to the disciples, and if you remember in John chapter 14, Jesus told His disciples, He says, look, I'm going to go and prepare a place for you, and where I go you know, and the way you know. And Thomas, the doubting disciple, says, Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way? And what did Jesus say? I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Well, Thomas, the doubter, at Jesus' resurrection, when He appeared after He rose from the grave, Thomas wasn't present one day. The other disciple says, hey, you've got to see this. Jesus is alive. He says, I won't believe it unless what? I put my hands in the scars and see for myself. Jesus appeared again later on to Thomas and said, look, here I am. Come, put your hands in mine. Here's my side. And what did Thomas say? My Lord and my God. His belief was fully realized that day. But we know Jesus actually rose from the dead. It's a fact. It's difficult, I understand, for many people to grasp. And you know what? If I saw someone pass away and then I saw them rise again, I would probably humanly have a difficult time with it as well. But Jesus did. Let me share with you today the resurrection from Mark's perspective. We happen to have Mark right here in the back with us today. Mark 16, 1 through 11. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb? But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. Don't be alarmed, he said. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter. Isn't it interesting that he said, go tell his disciples and Peter? He is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Now, some manuscripts do not have these verses, but anyway, read verses 9 through 11. When Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, He appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom He had driven seven demons. She went and told those who had been with Him and who were mourning and weeping. When they heard that Jesus was alive and that she had seen Him, they did not believe it. Four quick things to share with you, four simple things anyway. This is my humble attempt at a brief exposition here today. Number one, if you're a note taker, sometimes the closest people just don't believe. You've probably heard it said that some of the most difficult people for you to convince to believe in Jesus are the people that you live with.
Right.
So anyway, some of the closest people just don't believe. You see, now in verse 1, it starts out, when the Sabbath was over. The Sabbath is from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday. And so sometime Saturday evening, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, and Salome bought spices. As I was researching this earlier, I have run across some questions in the Christian world that some people were questioning, and one person even went so far as to say, now the Bible doesn't say when they bought the spices. Yes, it does. They bought it after the Sabbath. They wouldn't have had any reason to buy it before Jesus wasn't dead. And they didn't know that he was going to die. Oh, yes, he told his disciples, but there was no reason for Mary Magdalene and Mary his mother and Salome to buy these burial spices. So the Bible says very plainly, they bought them after the Sabbath was over. But note, John 19:39 says, and it reveals that Nicodemus had already bought and had applied burial spices to Jesus' dead body. And these spices that Nicodemus bought totaled 75 pounds worth of myrrh and aloe. That's a lot of burial spices. So you might ask the natural question, well, if Nicodemus had already done that, why do these ladies need to go and do it again? Well, Jews did not practice embalming. Thus, the process of decomposition would be accelerated because all the bodily fluid would still be there and it would increase the decomposition rate. And of course, there would be a very strong odor. Simply put, these ladies came to the tomb to continue the practice of Jewish custom, to anoint the body. And you know what? They also wanted to anoint the body of their Lord and their Savior. They didn't want him to smell. That would be dishonorable. And so they didn't want that to happen. So they would come and they would anoint him as long as there was a decomposition odor. That's a very practical reason for why they were going and why they bought these spices. But don't miss this. The fact that these ladies went through the trouble to buy these spices and travel to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body simply means they didn't believe he was going to rise again. And so sometimes the closest people don't fully believe. Jesus had cast out 7 demons from Mary Magdalene. Mary was his mother, and Salome, oh my gosh, what a ministry. These women were very close to Jesus, but in their grief, and the fact that they saw with their own eyes that Jesus died on the cross and was carried and buried into the tomb and the stone was put in place, they didn't believe. They came to do the normal Jewish custom of anointing the body. So sometimes, the people that are closest don't fully believe or truly believe. Second thing, the truth is often alarming. Notice that this angel said to them, don't be alarmed. And, well, they were alarmed when they walked into the tomb and saw Jesus wasn't there. Instead, it was a man robed in white. And it says, very early on the first day of the week, so that's Sunday morning. Okay, Sunday morning, just after sunrise, the scripture says, now, while en route to the tomb, these ladies asked a very good question. Who's going to roll away the stone for us? The angels did not roll away the stone from the entrance of the grave so that Jesus could get out. They rolled the stone away so that people could get in and people could see the fact that Jesus was alive, that he had risen. There was no need for them to roll the stone away for Jesus to get out. This is an complete, all-powerful, omnipotent God. He made the stone. He can surely roll the stone away. Amen? He didn't need angels to do that, but human beings would need to see and get in and discover that Jesus was alive.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And that's so sitting on the right side. And it says, the Bible says that they were alarmed. Sometimes the truth is alarming. Think about our truth that you have been made aware of that you previously were not aware of, and you were you were alarmed by it. You were shocked by it. It really struck you. These ladies, they probably, I don't know about you, but pass out? I mean, fall out? Oh my gosh, it really is true. Where is he? The angel said, hey, you're looking for Jesus the Nazarene, but guess what? He is risen. He's not here. He's alive. The best news that anybody could ever hear. Now, in Luke's gospel, he mentions two angels, and Mark only mentions one. And there's a very simple explanation for that. Only one of them spoke. The one that said, hey, you're looking for Jesus of Nazarene. He's not here. He is risen.
Amen.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen indeed. All right, come on, you Baptists. Let's get with it. But now imagine this. You're entering a grave. You're entering a tomb. You've been walking all this distance, anticipating. Now, you already knew there was a stone in front of the grave. You saw, you were there, right? You already knew there was a stone, and you're coming to do this customary Jewish practice of anointing this dead body, and yet you're coming up to the grave, and you know there's a stone there. All right, so who's going to roll away for us? Because we want to get in, and we want to do this. And you walk up, and before you ever get there, you see the stone is gone. You might have hurriedly rushed in to see, oh my gosh, what's happened? Well, I don't need to worry about the stone anymore, but I walk in and I see that there's not a dead body, but there's what appears to be a living person sitting there. Talk about alarming. Talk about arresting. Would you not have been arrested by that? Alarmed by that? Shocked by that?
Yes.
Yep. And not only that, this person speaks to you and says, hey, I know who you're looking for, but he is not here. But you knew coming into this that you're going to see a dead body. And there's no dead body. You knew that there was a stone, and yet the stone had been rolled away. And instead of finding a dead body, you find an angel. You would be alarmed too, to say the least. Sometimes the truth is alarming. Third thing, there's news worth telling. He said, the angel said, don't be alarmed. He has risen. He is not here. You see, the resurrection of Jesus has many critical aspects to our Christian faith. And number one, Jesus kept his promise to rise from death. Therefore, you can trust him to keep his promises.
Amen.
All of them. The biggest one is, I'm going to die for your sin. Pay the price for your sin. I'm going to die, but I'm going to rise again, and I'm going to prove to you that I'm going to take your sin away. Behold the Lamb of God which taketh away the sins of the world, John the Baptist said, when he saw Jesus walking on the side of the Jordan River, the banks of the Jordan River. He says, I'm going to take your sin away, but I'm going to rise from the grave. Proving that I have power over death. You can trust Jesus to keep his promises. Number two, Jesus is a living God, and his kingdom has a living king. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. Get ready to sing that in just a few minutes. Right? Are we going to sing that? Nope. Okay. Never mind. We sang it, right? Okay, I knew I heard it somewhere. No other religion can say that. Only Jesus rose from the dead. Only Jesus, the King of the Jews, the King of Kings, and the Lord of Lords, the King of all the universe, he is the only leader of every religion throughout the world who has ever risen from the dead. Christianity is not made up of dramatic dreams, incredible ideas, or happenstance hopes. It is a fact that Jesus rose from the grave. You know, unfortunately and sadly, there are so many people that don't believe that. Third thing, Jesus rising from death ensures that all who trust in him as Savior will rise from death too. One day. Jesus comes on the clouds, and we call that the rapture. And he comes to take his church out, all believers. All the dead in Christ are going to rise first. And then those of us who are alive and remain alive until that time, we're going to meet the Lord in the air, and we're going to be with them, and we're going to be changed. We're going to be given a glorified body to be like that of Jesus. But all who die believing in Jesus are going to rise from death too. Fourth thing, the same power that rose Jesus from the grave is in all who believe in him now. Therefore, we can live victoriously now and forever. We're not going to necessarily live the way that we are. And who wants to take this old broken down body with them, right? Come on. I want something brand new. I want something without the aches and pains. I want something without the COVID-19 worries and so on and so on. Don't you? I don't want to take this thing with me. It's faulty and flawed and it's fractured and it's broken and it's painful. Is the substance of our belief and gives us the greatest news to share with the world. I serve a risen Savior, not a dead one, not a statue on a table somewhere with all kinds of candles and incense and all that kind of craziness and so on and so forth. I don't serve a Savior that once lived and now he's dead and never to be again. I serve a risen Savior who's in the world today, and I know that he's living no matter what men may say. Why? Because he lives in me and he lives in you and all who believe in him. Amen?
Amen.
I serve a risen Savior. That's the greatest news. It's news worth telling. Who are you telling today? Fourthly, others may not believe.
True.
You ever told someone something they just didn't believe in? And you knew it to be the absolute, verifiable, factual truth. And they said, I don't believe it. That doesn't necessarily have to be a faith question. It could be anything. You've told someone something and they just don't believe it. You can't make someone believe. But others may not believe you. However, that does not diminish the truth. You see, the scripture says, when they heard that Jesus was alive and that she, Mary Magdalene, had seen him, saw him with her own eyes, proved, verifiable, factual, I saw him with my own eyes, they did not believe. Verse 11. The disciples didn't believe. I can't tell you the number of times that I've shared the gospel with people, but many times there often appears to be this glossy, glassy look over their eyes. You can see they don't get it. They don't believe it. You can't make someone believe. But, and maybe I present it in a boring way. I don't know. But it doesn't stop me from telling other people about Jesus. I don't always do it well, I confess that. But I have to trust that God will take my pitiful effort and use it to bring someone to him in his way and in his time. And hopefully you do the same. The gospel is the greatest news that the world has ever heard, but unfortunately many people are not listening. You know, I'm hoping that during this COVID-19 pandemic that a lot of ears are open. And a lot of eyes are open, and a lot of hearts are open to the truth of Jesus.
Amen.
That in spite of pandemic disease, and in spite that there is death in the world, and death is tragic, it's never, ever a pretty thing. Never. But I'm hoping that in light of and in spite of the fact that these things are happening in our world today, globally, that many people will come to believe in Jesus. You know, in addition to face masks and gloves and those kinds of things, there has been a dramatic increase in Bible sales since the COVID-19 outbreak.
Amen.
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 A dramatic increase in Bible sales. Maybe, just maybe, God is using this pandemic to draw people to himself. People have questions and they want to know what if, how. how, when, and so on and so forth. And maybe, just maybe, their curiosity is turning them to search the scriptures for answers, which is where they should have been looking all along. But maybe, just maybe, that's what God is doing. He can turn a tragedy into triumph. And maybe that's what he's doing. Easter is all about the resurrection of Jesus. And it's only about the resurrection of Jesus. However, comma, because Jesus is alive, it's also about any and all who profess and know him as Savior, and how you too can live after death. Only he has conquered death, and therefore only he can give you the same victory. But all who cry out by faith to Jesus and believe that he and he alone can save their soul for all eternity will in fact receive eternal life. If you would do that now, maybe you already have, and maybe everyone here today has. But maybe someone is hearing this for the first time. Would you do that today, right now, and begin to walk in the newness of life in Christ, knowing his peace and feeling the freedom that we just sang about that comes from being forgiven of sin and given the life that is truly life? Would you do that today? Would you call upon the name of the Lord? Cry out by faith and ask him to save your soul for all eternity. He will. He's wanting. He's ready. Are you? He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen. He is risen indeed. Lord, thank you that we serve a risen Savior. Thank you, God, that we have Jesus as our Savior and Redeemer. And God, because he lives, we too will live. Because he lives, we can face this pandemic. Because he lives, we can face today and tomorrow, should it come or tarry. Because he lives, we have victory. Because he lives, we live. God, for as many who would call out to Jesus by faith right now, this day, hear their prayers, save their souls, give them life that is eternal. Change them from the inside out and make them a new creature and a new creation, living and serving for you. We thank you, Lord. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
offer. Other denominations might call it the Eucharist, which simply means Thanksgiving. We can call it that, even though we're a Baptist church. I've already given the folks here some instruction, and so we know what we're going to do. We're going to play a video during the communion. Those of you who are listening and watching from home, we're going to have a time right now. We're going to bless both the bread and the fruit of the vine. And when you are ready, you take and eat in memory of Jesus. But let's have a few moments to prepare our hearts and our minds, if you would bow with me. Heavenly Father, thank you. Again, the words thank you really are far from adequate. They're very inadequate. But there really are no better words, humanly speaking. But with a heartfelt gratitude, God, I pray that you will hear our prayers. And that as we pray to you, giving you thanks for the sacrifice that you made in the giving of your only begotten Son, sacrificing him for our sin, my sin. Will we come before your table with humble hearts, but also with uplifted hearts? Because if you had not sent Jesus, and if he had not gone to the cross, and if he had not died for our sin, and if he had not risen from the grave, and shown that he has power over death, Lord, we would be hopeless, beyond hopeless. So thank you, God, that in your infinite wisdom, you would see our deepest need, and you would give up your only Son, and put him on the cross in our place where we rightfully deserve to go for the payment of our sin and feeling the penalty for our sin, God. Thank you that you would spare us by sacrificing Jesus. God, in this holy moment and in this reverent moment, as we come before your table, we ask you, Lord, to bless the bread that represents Jesus' body and the cup filled with the fruit of the vine that represents Jesus' blood. Bless it, God. Bless each and every person who partakes, and who has that humble spirit and has the right heart and takes in a humble way with thanksgiving. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you. It's in Jesus' name that we do so. Amen. Normally we have the Lord's Supper on the first Sunday of every month. And I think this is the first time that I've ever had the Lord's Supper on Easter Sunday. At least in recent memory. But it's very fitting that we observe this today, because a few days ago was Maundy Thursday. The Thursday of Holy Week, when Jesus and his disciples had gathered into the upper room of an unknown follower of Christ, and they had shared in the Passover meal. After the Passover meal, Jesus took out a piece of hidden bread, and he took it out of a pouch referred to as the Afikoman. Three chambers was in that pouch. Symbolically, could represent Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and perhaps this piece of bread was in the center pouch, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he took out this piece of bread, and he gave his Father thanks, and he distributed it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my body which is given for you, broken for you." And he told them to eat it as they remembered. And after he took a cup, we know to have been called the cup of redemption during the Passover meal. And he said, "In this cup is a new covenant in my blood." covenant, that promise is to redeem us, to buy us back. And he did that when he went to the cross and rose from the grave 3 days later. And he told his disciples to take it in remembrance of him. Allie, would you come? Those of you who are at home, we'll play this video as we each here come and get our elements of the Lord's Supper, take them back to our respective seats. Glorious day. fruit of the vine that represents the blood of Jesus shed on Calvary's tree, paying the price for your sin and mine. You see, the scripture says there is no forgiveness of sin without the shedding of blood. Take this in remembrance of Jesus. Amen. Let's pray again. Thank you all for tuning in with us on Facebook Live. I hope you have a wonderful Easter. Enjoy your family as much as you can, staying 6 feet apart, of course. And be blessed. We'll see you again next week. Until then, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Lord, thank you that we serve a risen Savior. Thank you that you've given to us this day. I pray, God, that we will be ever changed by our gathering this morning, and that you are ultimately looking down upon us from heaven, and you are smelling a pleasing aroma by the praises and the songs that we sing and by our gathering today. Lord, again, we thank you for this day, and we ask, God, that you'll be with us as we go. We thank you again. We praise you in Jesus' name. And everyone said together, Amen. Amen.